thank everyone for coming. It's a great turnout. My name is Harrison Handler. I'm the executive director for the Mount Washington Valley Housing Coalition. I've been working with this group for about the past month, getting this put together for you all so that you can better understand the ordinance that's going to be coming forward next week. What we did is we did a charrette, which basically what we did is took this idea of what cluster housing would be, and instead of just talking about it in the nuts and bolts of what the ordinance is and what it allows, we decided to actually design a couple housing developments and show you what it would look like if it were implemented here in Conway. This is an educational event. It's not necessarily an advocacy event. We're not trying to tell you how to vote. We're just trying to make sure you understand what it is that you're voting on. With me tonight is Mel Torres, the planning director for the town of Conway, Kate Richardson, project manager for Bergeron Technical, Chris Dockers, an architect with Olson Lewis, and Ailey Byers, who's the vice chair of the Conway Planning. So there's a couple terms that I might be throwing around and that you might hear from these guys as well that I do want to just go over real quick before we get started. You're probably going to hear me anyway. This acronym comes out of my mouth like 20 times a day. This is AMI. It's Area Median Income. So basically the concept here is if you took everyone in Conway and lined them up based on how much money they make and then you take the person in the middle, that's what you get. For Carroll County, we do a lot of this talking about county level. For Carroll County, that's $75,000 a year for a family of four. So that's not a single income, that is based on a family income. I believe we looked it up just before this, it was $62,000 for Conway, right? So it's a bit lower when you're talking about just the town of Conway taken out of the context of Carroll County. Workforce housing is defined by state statute. What that means is that it has to be a rental that is coming in at 60% of the area median income. And if it's something you're buying, it can be up to 100%. Now, how they calculate that is basically based on your 30% of your income for rent, and then 30% of your income for mortgage payments. Right? So those are the two numbers we're talking about. What that looks like for purchase, since what we're going to be talking about tonight is predominantly for sale units, 100% purchase rate for Carroll County is $334,000. So anything that is hitting $334,000 or below on the market right now is considered workforce housing for our area. Those numbers are all calculated by Housing and Urban Development, right? There are a lot of different mortgage types that are available to people through New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority that go up to 120% AMI. So anyone who is looking to purchase something at this rate can get a better loan if they go through our state housing authority. And that will help as far as making it more affordable for those people. So to that end, what we decided to do was come up with this ordinance, and Ailey was one of the folks who came up with it, so I'm going to turn it over to her to tell you all kind of the impetus behind creating this thing.
So I'm going to give credit where credit is due. Earl Sars, who's no longer with us, who's on the planning board, who's the initial creator of this, and then he and Tom Irving, who's also no longer involved in this, and I sat down and kind of tweaked some of these things. With the idea being, we have ordinances in the town currently for affordability and ways to make more dense housing in the town, but no one's ever really taken advantage of it. So we were trying to find alternative ways of creating more housing in the town. So we came up with this idea. The town allows us to have these special exemptions which we've never used in the town before. So that's what we decided to use. That way it will have to come before the planning board, any process that wanted to do this. And the idea is, you can see when Jamel goes and reads what's actually in the ordinance, is there's nothing in there necessarily restricting that it's affordable, but we still wanted to create more volume of units in town. Supply and demand, if you remember back from classes in high school, is about the marketplace, and so there is a trickle-down effect from having more supply. So even if they're not necessarily affordable, there is lots of studies showing that by having more units, it creates more upward mobility in the middle section, because those people kind of in the middle levels of buying ability, you can buy units, and that opens up housing at the lower levels for people to kind of infill at the bottom. So that is the idea behind where we came up with the cluster housing.
Thanks, Haley.
And now Joel's going to go into specifics.
Yep, so I'll nerd out with some planning. So I'm going to read through the 7 standards one by one and answer questions later. So there's 7 standards for the cluster housing section of the Affordable Housing Ordinance that's proposed next Tuesday. And number 1 is all dwelling units shall be single family detached structures or duplexes and shall not include manufactured or mobile homes. You guys hear me okay? Yep. All dwelling units shall be served by municipal water and sewerage. All dwelling units shall have a floor area not less than 400 square feet or greater than 1,200 square feet. And this really isn't, it's just a provision that really allows for smaller housing units on the market that would ideally cost less to purchase for the consumer on the market. And it's, we're looking for a naturally occurring affordability in the market for these unit sizes. Keep going. All dwelling units shall be used for long-term residency and as primary residences, and short-term transient occupancy of any dwelling unit is prohibited. Legal documents shall be reviewed and approved by the planning board with lease terms of no less than 180 days or half a year. The minimum lot size shall be 1/4 acre for the first unit and 5,000 square feet for each additional dwelling unit on a lot, which is the same density as the Affordable Housing Ordinance that's in place. The minimum frontage for any lot shall be 50 feet, which is quite a bit less than most districts in town, except for the commercial village districts in the 3 villages in town. And then the conditional use permit shall not be combined with any other conditional use permit or special exception, including but not limited to special exceptions for accessory dwelling units.
And one quick note, because I'm sure it'll come up, the language that talks about not being manufactured in mobile homes, our current definitions are old and aren't really quote accurate, so we had to use those terms to comply with our current codes, but you would be able to use modular. You would be able to use modular in this, and we hope to update the definitions of our code next year to reflect the way the federal government HUD define manufactured mobile and modular homes. Yes. Our codes are just old.
We're working on it.
We're working on it.
All right, perfect.
So what we wanted to do is make sure that we can come back to the technical things, and certainly after the presentation we'll open up to Q&A. But what we wanted to do was really be able to show you all what these would look like. One of the biggest stipulations when we were trying to, one of the biggest issues we ran into as we were trying to find lots for this, is the requirement that it must be on town water and sewer. New Hampshire DES, Department of Environmental Services, has specific qualifications as far as subsurface waste systems are concerned. So you actually cannot get these densities by state law if you are doing it off of a sewer system, right? If you're trying to use a septic system, even if it's on a communal level, it's not going to cut it for the density. That's why we had to err on the side of using sewer. But that's the thing, we're pretty limited as far as where that is available. So where we have water and sewer immediately constricts where we can do this. And so what we found as we were coming up with lots is that what this will most likely be used for is a lot of what we call infill development or incremental development. And what infill development means is we're going to take a lot that likely was either substandard to begin with or could only maybe have 1 unit on it based on standard density, and instead we'll upgrade it to have 2 units using this density. So we're not really talking, we tried to find lots that we would be able to build huge neighborhood developments to show what this would do, but to be honest, we couldn't find them. Right? So the reality is where this would be used, given our current infrastructure for the town of Conway, is most likely that it would be used on small scale development, getting anywhere between our largest one that we have is 16 units. Right? So with that being said, I'm going to turn it over to Kate Richardson, who will talk a little bit about the locations that we came up with, and then we will show you guys what we did.
So the first lot that we chose was a smaller lot located in Conway Village. The owners of that lot are here with us tonight, Jessica DiPietro and Christian Manhart. They were very kind to let us use their property as an example property. This property is more of the example of the infill development. It's very small in terms of density. It's half an acre total. So this lot, we could get two units using this ordinance. The lot is located right across. It's on the cemetery side of the road as you're heading towards West Side Road on Washington Street. It's right by the Triangle Square. So that's the smaller lot that we used for this. Our mid-sized lot is a lot located right in North Conway Village. Many of you might know it as the former elementary school lot, which is located right next to the post office. That lot was a great example of, a mid-sized lot. It's right in the village. It's vacant. It's a nice level lot. So we were able to fit four units on it using this density. And then our third property is located right next to Cranmore off Ski Mobile Road. As you're heading down Ski Mobile Road, you go over the brook, the bridge to the brook. It's right there on the right-hand side. It used to have a condominium development on it, which was torn down. The property was taken by the state for the bypass. So it's currently for sale, and the folks at Badger have been nice enough to let us use that lot. And that was a larger lot that we could find, within the districts we were looking for in a residential-ish neighborhood. And we were able to get 16 units on this property using the density calculations for the cluster housing development.
Chris will turn it over to you, and I'll be your banner, unless you want.
So we have the three lots. Thanks to Kate for putting together the initial site for us. And so what we did is we said, okay, well, if we have the lot and the site plan, we did a calculation based on the ordinance. And again, as Kate said, in this instance, so this is the lot off of Washington Street. And so the lot is here. Then the next thing we did, once we had the lot and some of the restrictions. So in this case here, what I did is, so there's river, there's wetlands, there's FEMA floodplain, and then there's the set zoning setbacks. So basically, you figure out what's left for building. And fortunately, there was enough room for two units, which the ordinance allows us to do. So in this case, one of the things that I always like to do when I'm doing, especially these info lots, is to draw the line of where a lot of the existing structures are along the street. Because what we want to do is at least try to continue a pattern that's there so that whatever we do looks like it fits in and it belongs, it's always been there. In this instance, though, the zoning setback is actually a little bit greater than where that line would be. So we bring it as close as we can to the street. The model for the units, and this is all best, just very diagrammatic, just to sort of see how we might lay these things out, is so this is a duplex, even though it looks like a single family. So the idea is that to continue the infill and the pattern on the streets, which are mostly single family, is to create something that looks like a single family, but it's actually a two family. And this is designed in a way so that it could be built modular. It doesn't have to be, but it could be. And so there are two units here, two stories each, and each one's about 500 square feet, the other's about 600 square feet per floor. So that's 1,000, 1,200 square feet, which is within the ordinance. In this case, what we did, because the lot was relatively narrow, so we pushed a garage into the back. That allows us to have a nice yard outside of the units, and then also have access to parking. So that's that lot. On the mid-sized lot, which is on CB Street. So here's the post office, here's CB Street, and here's the lot. In this case, based on the ordinance, we were able to get four units. So what we did again is there's this line here of existing pattern of homes, and the zoning setback actually allows us to go closer to the street. What we want to do is continue this existing pattern, so we pushed it back. So we have the two duplexes. These are both duplexes, again, similar model. And then in this instance here, we did something a little bit different. So we wanted to try a couple of different things. We wanted to see garages, no garages, carports. So in this case, we're proposing a carport. And there's this existing access road and an easement off of the access drive to the post office property that where we can actually come in off into the carport area. And it turns out this faces south, so a nice place to put solar panels on the roof of that carport. And that way it keeps the front of the house and the neighborhood more pedestrian oriented. So we don't have to provide a curb cut and a driveway off of CB Street, but we can add additional sidewalks to get, and it allows us to have a nice yard behind each of the duplexes. So in this case, and just because we can fit it, we put in an 8-car carport. Some of it can be storage or that sort of thing, and cars, and then 4 units at about 1,000 to 1,200 square feet apiece.
Chris, who owns that lot?
The Goldberg Foundation. Goldbergs.
And so, on this, so this is now the ski mobile lot. Now this lot was actually larger, so it's almost 3 acres. We actually combined two lots here. Based on the calculation from the ordinance, we could actually get 24 units on here. But again, we go through this exercise where we indicate the setbacks. There's a river, wetlands. We don't end up with a whole lot of room left on the site. About half the site is left that we can actually develop. And so in this case, because it's relatively narrow, what we do is put in a road and then a turnaround for the fire engines and deliveries, that sort of thing. And typically we do those 60 feet diameter for that so that we can do that. And then we're just creating a little neighborhood along that street. In this case, there are 8 duplexes. And again, similar model. Sometimes we rotate them a little bit so we can get, we actually tucked another one in the back because there's a little bit extra room back there. But in this case, they don't have garages. The road's a little bit wider, it's 30 feet. The drive only has to be 24 feet, so there's an opportunity potentially for parking along there or on the site. We didn't get into a lot of detail either about the plans or the parking and that sort of thing. Sort of a diagram to say, how might they lay out on the site? And how many could they actually get? Like in this case, this was an interesting exercise because ordinance actually allowed 24, but once we actually did the technical piece of it and laid it out, it can only fit 16 units. And then just to see what would happen, and so because the ordinance allows us to do both single family and duplex, our goal here is to try and maximize the number of units. So the duplex is allowed us to do that. If we started adding single family homes on it, which we could do, the density would be less. So the goal here was really to try and increase the density as much as possible. So this is another option for the ski mobile lot. And we said, well, what if we added garages? So again, the same thing happens, right? We only end up with 10 units. Because by the time we add the garages, the units, the duplexes get a lot larger. And so we can't fit as many on there. So those are some quick diagrams of how these, each of these three, the smaller, medium, and larger sites that we could find, and how they laid out some of the calculation exercises that we learned, and then what it might look like.
Excellent. Thanks so much, Chris. And so now we're going to get to the part that I think everyone is really looking for, which is, what is this going to cost people? And are we able to make these things to be, to some degree, affordable? And so I apologize, our developer who worked with us on this project, Chris Lee, was unable to make it today. He recently had a child, and then his business partner recently had a child, and so they're all over the place trying to get their work done, and so he couldn't make it up. But he provided for us building costs based on duplex developments he's been doing recently, using modular style construction. He does a lot of affordable development in Massachusetts and in southern Maine. And so he provided us the per building costs. Bergeron was able to use some of their connections and get estimated site costs for us as far as the land moving and prep work that would have to be done on the site prior to it being built. And so what we did is we kind of put that together. I want to make sure we're all clear. These are very rough numbers, right? So these are rough numbers, and it's also, I forgot to reiterate this at the beginning, this is all theoretical. We're not setting out to build this stuff, right? This is just to show you what it would look like. So on the Washington Street site, we estimated roughly $30,000 just in site prep work. The per building cost, and this is the same for every single one of them, it's just multiplied by how many buildings there are going to be.
What's the square footage?
So each building is going to be roughly 2,000 square feet, with the units being about 1,000 square feet each. And so those unit square footage fits with the density requirements. So the per building cost, he estimated it to be about $464,560 per building. So when you add those together and then divide it up by the number of units, you get about $247,280 as the cost to get one of those duplex units. On CD Street, and again, that's number, it's on the first page here, but this number is falling within that workforce housing range. CD Street, about $171,000 for site work. Buildings is just times two, so it's $929,120, and that gives us a per unit cost of about $275,000. And Cranmore is the interesting one to see, because again, it speaks to why we look for density when we're trying to reach some sort of affordability. A big part of that is getting the land cost per unit down, which helps the site cost per unit down. That division is an important part of the calculation. So on the 8 building setup, where there's no garages, the site work is 645. And again, that's the same in both. It doesn't matter how many units you're going to be putting in, you've got to get it prepped. So 645, building cost $3,716,480, brings you a per unit cost of $272,592. Now that exact same site, when you shave three buildings off, comes down to being the building cost of $2,322,800 and a per unit cost of $296,000. So there's a pretty big discrepancy here, simply in the fact that we're able to squeeze three more buildings in, which makes all the difference in the world when you're trying to make those calculations for folks to get into these buildings, into these units. So this is kind of the main idea as to why we're seeking a density relief. For this type of unit construction is to help get closer to these figures. And just to give you an idea, Jess pulled some numbers for us this morning. Jessica DiPietro, it works over at Badger Realty. And so we have, just to give you an idea of kind of where these land as far as current market. So as of today, there have been 27 closings in the town of Conway. So 27 buildings have sold, residential units have sold in Conway. If you include condominiums, that number goes up to 60. The average listing price currently in Conway from January 1st to now is $489,890. The median listing price is about $500,000. So we're looking at pretty high property values at this point. And of course, the big part is what does that boil out to as far as the actual purchase? Our average sale price right now in Conway is $488,000. So we're coming in about $200,000 under that per unit, which again is kind of putting the impetus with the fact that we're looking to make sure that these are deed restricted to be for local living, for someone to live in year round, or for seasonal living for half the year. That is looking more to meet the demographic and the income levels of our area. So that's what we're hoping to achieve with this. And to that end, there are some huge economic benefits to having the inclusion of duplexes being used more widely in our communities, as well as other multifamily style housing. And Jessica actually has some lived experience with that. So I'll turn it over to Jess to talk about that a little bit.
First, I just want to clarify that those numbers that Harrison was talking about are single family homes. So there have been more sales than in the town of Conway, but those are just the single family homes. So from the point of view of the duplex, if like I was talking to Harrison about earlier, I personally think it's probably one of the best, most economical designs that we can go with. One of the main reasons is because it allows so many more options. And a perfect example would be, so Christian is over there, he's my husband. When we bought our house, it was a duplex. And this was four years ago. And being able to purchase that duplex, is the reason we were able to purchase it. Because we lived in one side, and then we rent out the other side year-round, and that rental income offsets our mortgage and our insurance and our costs. So having that duplex style is going to be much more, I say, inclusive, and it'll cut down on the barriers to entry into the home ownership, like I said, we've experienced firsthand.
Perfect. And to clarify, the numbers we have up there are for half of the building, right? So that's if you were to purchase kind of condo-wise half of the lot. But what's important and what Jess brings up is that, again, if we double this to facilitate someone who wants to buy the whole building, we're still not hugely over what is considered probably in the 120 AMI range. And when we are looking at our hospital that is hurting desperately for any type of physician to come work for them, that our optometrist offices are all saying, no, sorry, we can't take any new clients because we don't have any people, right? We're looking to also incentivize bringing in kind of the median to upper median income range as far as professionals that would then be providing rental units on top of that. So it is a kind of win-win scenario as well. And so that is our presentation, and I would be, when we're done with Q&A, if anyone wants to come up and take a closer look at these, please feel free. But now I'll turn over to questions.
I have a question. I just want to add something to what Jess had said. I'm a realtor, Kimberly Clark. I'm a selectman of Bartlett and a realtor. I did a search in Conway, Bartlett, Jackson, Madison, and Albany for homes 250 to 400, zero active listing right now. So that's what we're dealing with right now. So
to kind of piggyback off that too, I did something similar, and I looked at our website. So this isn't the MLS, this isn't Zillow, this isn't anything. So on the Badger, PB, and Smith website, I looked at how many people created an account on the site and saved a search for properties in Conway up to with the max price point of $450, and there are over 6,000 active saved searches.
The banks have hundreds of pre-approved buyers, so the demand is definitely there. We just need to clean the inventory. My question on the square footage, you said a limited of 1,200 square feet. Does that also, would you be allowed to do an unfinished garage in addition to that? Because the one problem I see with the small houses, no garages, and we have a huge problem of people having storage, especially with our active community. So could you do a 1,200 square foot above grade finished space, but have an unfinished basement as well?
I do not think so. It says dwelling unit, so it'd be the living area. I think the cost of a garage and the building would make it more expensive.
But as far as could you do it and
could you meet the standards if you did a 1,200 square foot house but had an unfinished below grade garage, so like no egress windows or walkouts, but it was an unfinished garage space below? And primarily, I think of storage, washer, dryer, you know, that kind of thing.
So long as it wasn't a livable area.
Okay.
So if it was changed or converted into that, then it wouldn't be the ordinance.
Right.
Because I understand that.
Okay. Thank you.
Hi, Bob. I'm a landscape architect in Riverdale. So the exercise is really good. The numbers are very reasonable. I just want to thank you for going to that. Bringing it in at this level and the drawings are really nice. So I guess the questions that I have, I'll nudge you on this a little bit.
Of course.
Basically it's been limited to one, single and duplex units. There are dozens, if not hundreds, of unit types out there that fit into the neighborhood context of what we're talking about that are more units than that. And I'm just curious why it's held down, because the efficiency of a multi
term that Robert did an excellent job of explaining, that using the housing term, I think it's the missing middle housing, right? So we're talking about this space in the housing realm where you have single family homes, right, which is what most of us live in, and then you have apartment buildings and condo buildings. But what about all of the things in between that we could have and could exist? And that includes duplexes, fourplexes, that includes cottage courts, so you know, really small houses, small lots, kind of all tightening it together, PUDs, things like that. And so to answer that question, I think what we wanted to do is we want to see the change, and I believe, and I would turn to Ailey on this, but in my opinion anyway, I think that for now this is a good step in the right direction, and would love to see how this is utilized and how this fills in some of our spaces, and if people are loving it and liking it, we can say, well, we can do more with this. There's more to be had here if we want to go after it.
That's an excellent strategy. Thank you. That's a really great thing. It gets people steps into a comfort zone, which is super important. So it's just that some of us with gray hair need a little impatient of it. Some of us are going to be aging in place.
And to that end, I would like to add, we did reference, obviously, a huge part of this is that it is supposed to be local housing. And we have read a lot of articles and done studies on other tourist destinations in the country, and they're starting to utilize this deed restriction as it must be lived in, right? And either if that means it's a lease and someone's living there long term, or if it is your primary residence, either is fine, but it must be lived in. And so we had a lot of back and forth about what would be those lease terms. If you're not living in it, but you're renting it, what would that look like? And we had to turn to our demographics. And we said, honestly, we're in one of the oldest parts of one of the oldest states in the country. And there are a lot of folks who do not want to live here year round because the summer gets too hot, right? And so the result, we said, we want to make sure that these folks can move and move into a unit like this and live in it for half the year and then provide housing to our seasonal workers for half the year. And that's really important to us, especially for that aging in place piece. I also work with the Mount Washington Valley Intrepid Community. I'm the chair of the housing domain there. And that's something that we're constantly looking at is, you know, how does this interplay with our community and making sure we're able to keep these people in our community, the aging demographic, is immensely important to us. And so this allows them to downsize, to move into a smaller unit, remain in the community, and then that frees up a larger unit that a family can move into, or that someone who wants to move into the area can move into. So one of the biggest issues is when we have such short stock, as was described by Jess. You know, we've got, and you know, we said, you know, zero active listings right now. We've got stagnation in our housing stock. And so you have folks, I've talked to many people who medically cannot access half of their house. They can't get up the stairs anymore. They can barely get, you know, they can't go down to the service room in the basement. They need somewhere else to go, and there is nowhere else to go. So they now have half of the house that's completely unutilized for our community. We have looked at models of home sharing, right? So bringing someone in to rent that upper floor, but not everyone's comfortable with that. So this is something that utilizes a different living style. It has people who are going to be close by, so if someone is aging, they might feel more comfortable knowing that there's someone just on a knock away on the wall if they want to do it really hard. Right, but that's the whole point, is making sure that we're getting that rotation back in the stock. The Upjohn Institute in 2019 did a really interesting study that showed that when you put this housing into a community, that actually most mobility you see is in the bottom 20% of income. They're the ones who benefit the most from this housing existing because it creates that rotation of stock that opens up better spaces for them to live in. Any other questions?
I would just like to applaud you for the 180 days because the 6 months is just as hard to find for people as the year. And especially when you have new employees that locate here. You know, I had a client, for example, and he had relocation assistance, and we couldn't find any place for him to stay other than a hotel. And to be able to introduce people to the area under a 6 month lease, but they perhaps they're going to look for permanent larger housing elsewhere, but that is a huge plus, as is staffing the ski industry, because those snowbirds that go south, there are people that work only the ski industry in the winter, and might just be the hosts that come up and work weekends, or our ski coaches they need places to live, so I applaud that 180 day rule.
So what would be the max like rental? Like there's like a top number of like someone bought it and rented it to somebody in the market.
So with this provision that there is a floor, technically. In our affordability wise, so we're talking about these figures, the workforce figures. This rent, 60% AMI, only for Carroll County right now is $1,078 a month. That's a gross rent. So that's all utilities included. So estimating in Carroll County that utilities cost around $240 a month, shave that off, and you're looking at somewhere around $800 a month, it would be this rent here. Obviously, the homeowner could rent for, if someone owned both duplexes or if someone just lived in half of it and rented it out for 6 months, that would be up to them as to using the market rate. I have worked with many landlords actually recently, and I've done kind of analysis on our rental market and have been able to tell them what are, you know, reasonable brackets based on the incomes of, you know, whoever they're looking to own. So there are people who are actively engaged in that type of rent, looking to make sure that it fits.
So the prices are very different than the rent?
No,
So neither the price for buying it or for renting it is restricted, and part of the reason why we did that, why it's set up that way in this conditional use permit, is that we have other parts of our code that did have restrictions on those things, and we have it hasn't been used, and we've been told that from the builder standpoint, it's very hard for them to get financing from the banks to do the buildings if they're deed restricted in that way. So again, just to create more inventory, we removed that aspect, figuring that it's going to be higher because it's going to be market rate, but it's still going to create the units. The financing part of, well, of course, our builder isn't here. The financing part, when you put restrictions on what it can be rented at, is a big hurdle for the builders. They say they cannot get financing, so they have to basically build it from cash. And for most builders, they're not going to have $5 million in cash to build something, and they have to make back their money somehow. So, you know, we're trying to come at the problem from different angles, and we have, you know, angles set up that are for that control the rent or control the purchase price, and they haven't been used. So now we're trying to come at it from a different angle and see, well, if we just create more volume, maybe that'll help the problem, and we can find another angle to come at it. So I personally would love to see that, but that's just not, we're trying to figure out a different way of solving the problem.
And that's why we refer to the term naturally occurring affordability. So these are not deed restricted affordable. Instead, it's small units, small lots, must be a primary resident. That now narrows down the market as far as who can get into these units, which is going to impact the ability to price them at certain points. Because the reality is, you know, with that 6 month requirement, if you, let's be honest, this is the parking lot. These units would not sell at $270,000. So the reality here is that it is how much it will be, but
it wouldn't be listening. You're right. We could definitely sell it for $270,000. We wouldn't be listening to it.
Where you're going to get the natural restriction is the year lease. So there are only so many income levels that can support the higher prices where we are. Although more and more people can work from home, if you're gonna live there year round, you're gonna naturally attract more people that are in workforce housing, which is not low income housing, and that's the problem. Most people think it is. It's not low income housing. It's the average wage of the workforce.
And just as Harrison described as the mobility being that bottom sector, the same thing is for the rental market. So the creation of any type of unit, whether it be high end, low end, middle, by having that additional unit, there are many people who are in apartments or are renting places that would be in the lower rent, more affordable, and they have the income and the means, and maybe they want to have a child and they want something bigger to move to a bigger, larger unit, but again, there's no place for them to go. So if it's created, that sector will move to this mid sector, or maybe the higher sector, whatever it is, and it'll open up space. Really, the majority of the benefit is down in that lower tier.
And as we find when we're talking about the workforce housing law from the state of New Hampshire, it's primarily geared towards rental. And the reason for that is that that's mostly the demographic we're trying to meet. When you look at rental vacancy in the state of New Hampshire, it's currently at 0.9%. Because if you take every single rental unit in the state on a month-to-month basis, only 0.9 of them are going to be available for rent. For Carroll County, that number drops to 0.7. This whole study is done by the New Hampshire Housing Finance Authority. I am on the phone with them 3 times a day. So I said, hey, can you give me the data specifically for the Mount Washington Valley? So they gave me the data for the Mount Washington Valley. Carroll County is 0.7%, and the Mount Washington Valley is 0.
Yeah.
So everywhere else in Carroll County is 0.7, but we are unfortunately at about 0% vacancy rate. And what that really means, kind of from a communal standpoint, and we see this, there's several Facebook groups talking about long-term rental and things like that. What that really means is that when someone loses their rental opportunity, oftentimes that can equate to that is now a loss to the community because that person will have to move elsewhere. So again, having a diversity in our units would be immensely beneficial as far as making sure that we can meet the needs of our community. I thought I saw a question over here.
Yeah. So I just had a question as far as the lot sizing went. So I understand that it was a quarter acre lot, and then you had talked about a 5,000 square foot beyond that.
Mm-hmm.
So is that as far as like if you're dividing up a larger piece of land, that for each unit that you're putting from there, only needs to be 5,000 square foot?
Correct. It's a density calculation.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
So if you had a 5,000 square foot lot, which you wouldn't. But you, yeah. That would you've got a nice yard that you can go like. So you need the quarter acre first.
Yeah, just first.
Yes. Any 5,000 square feet you have after that is another unit.
Is another unit. So that's a duplex or single family.
Any kind of.
Well, so here's the thing, right? This one building
mm-hmm.
counts as two units, right? So we're talking unit calculation. So mm-hmm. this is four units, and this lot can handle. So we build something two buildings. The duplex is going to count as two units.
Okay.
And to Robin's point earlier, you could just have like a really nice classic New England looking farmhouse right here. That's got four units in it.
Yes.
Right. And as far as fitting in with CD Street, if you all are familiar with it, as you start getting back as the hill goes up, exactly what's there. Right. So I think it would fit seamlessly with the community and be providing four units on that one lot.
Yeah. I mean, I can show you neighborhoods throughout New Hampshire that are like 50 by 100 foot lots, and they are very liberal in that fabric of something. And some of those were created in like 1900, 1910. So these are historical settlement patterns. You can have one house that can have three units on it, you know, three flats on it. This would be a 1910 house divided into three units, next to a single family house. And then you might have a double lot next door that has like four row houses. All in the fabric of neighborhood. I guess my only concern is that I think you've set up some barriers for yourself that are reducing your potential on this. I wish the quarter acre pushes buttons because it's not an affordable density. It helps, but it feels like that's more hurdle than an opportunity. If you look at the loss around you.
The town of Conway does have other density incentives in the zoning, not necessarily in these zoning districts that we were looking at. For example, the town of Conway does have a special exception for older homes to be converted into apartment buildings.
Of which I am completely ignorant, so
and
help me
out. Also, we do have the special exception that allows a density up to 12 units per acre.
Great.
And I just did a project up at McGrath Tavern where we used that special exception wonderfully. We preserved an old building. We got 7 units in there. It was great. So this is just adding another layer to that. We do have multiple options. This is just another one. And this one, I think, and please correct me if I'm wrong here, I think this one helps us along with more residential neighborhoods. Whereas the other ones are more in town, they're in the highway commercial. commercial district, the village commercial districts, this ordinance would allow similar development, but extend that out to residential districts, and that's, you know, certainly the cluster, the multiple unit and the multiple building thing is great.
I drive around town, it's like, you know, house there, two units there, drive by, friends and visitors, crazy.
Yeah, it's just another tool in the toolbox.
Yeah, so, I mean, we do have others, there's absolutely 100% room for more.
It's great effort, and I don't mean to be critical, I just, I got a few barriers.
Yeah, and I guess you could look at the affordable housing ordinance too, where this, if it's passed, would live under, and that would incentivize more apartment style development.
Just, and you were talking about duplexes, that I have found is that if, there are, you know, like you guys, you bought a two unit structure for X amount of money, I'm assuming that's included a value added for that extra unit. See, maybe you paid more for the second unit, but sometimes this looks like it's basically a balance of how that each unit is equal. Whereas a lot of trends in duplexes is there's a larger and a smaller. And so that gives the owner, if it's an owner of two units, if you want to downsize and you want to move next door to the smaller unit and have more rental income, if you own the whole thing. Because, you know, duplexes are a tough condo. It's really hard to have a condo association with a duplex.
You can still do that,
but that's a hard one.
And again, this, you know, it was designed to give the town and builders multiple options. So, you know, how the builder, if they choose to use this to build something, how they choose to do it is going to be up to them. They should just stay within, you know, stay within the lines, you know, maybe one size bigger, one's different. That's, we're just giving them the boundaries to work with.
Well, and if it fits in the logic, and I don't mean to dominate, but I'm just enthusiastic over it. People aren't asking their questions, so I'm gonna keep this going.
We're surrounded by clients.
Is the duplex model fitting with a modular? It's perfect. It makes it so much more efficient. You don't have an 8-month construction season. You put a foundation, you have the house on order, and 3 days later, people are moving in. I mean, it's an amazing process. It needs some lead time, but it's not the site disturbance, and it's not also the, you know, the mobilization of everything on site. And also, it fits really, really nice with the scale of many of the builders in this region. So the small scale, incremental developer, this is people making their own decision to hire a local contractor, sourcing to a modular company. There's a modular company right down Route 16 in Dover, and they make fabulous, high energy, efficient structures. You know, you could do an order for all of these projects, get the order in, have all of them come and do all of it. You know, 2 weeks later, you have all of the units and sold. You can literally do this as a, you know, as sort of a collective like effort.
and as a, just for anyone who isn't 100% familiar with modular construction, if you know the aroma and the apartments that went up behind it, how it was kind of slept, like put together in these big bricks almost, that's modular construction. So they carted in these basically giant kind of bricks that are in the rooms, and they stacked them up and fastened them together, and there you go. Right? And it allowed them to put those two buildings up, you know, very quickly. And it is done much more affordably. So, and that's much more technical than that, but I wanted to.
That was good.
Did you address the ownership issue at all? Like, for example, that 16, where they envisioned as residential units. In other words, you own your footprint of your unit, and then there's just common land, so not condominium.
So I think mostly envisioned these as being planned unit developments,
right.
So it would be that way. Right. So in something like this, where you've got the 8 units, you would own
your portion,
and then 10 feet off the building.
Got it.
But all the rest of the land is
common
land. Right? And that allows you to get these to get them in tight like this.
Got it. Are there any kind of green space requirements?
You would still have to meet the requirements for site plan review. These projects would have to go before the planning board for concurrent site plan and subdivision review. So you'd have to meet the green space requirements based on that regulation.
Which is 25. That's a fit.
I answered
the
question, I'm sorry.
You can answer all of them. Which is 25%. That's the requirement for a state plan.
So since Chris mentioned, as we're looking at like specifically this immobile lot, this blue space is, you're not allowed to build it there, right? If you can't build on it, can you still count it as green space? So would this be considered the 25? So
I'm going to talk about
this. You can include anything in green space that isn't wetlands,
okay.
Or greater than 25% slope.
And other like characteristics.
Yeah. The setback for the wetlands you can count.
Yes.
Yes. Like in fact, you know, when you go to site plan review or subdivision, like the areas between the property line and the building setback are required to be vegetated, and that does count towards
the place. I like to look at it as buildable area. Sorry.
Yeah.
So, areas that you can actually build on without a lot of site work.
Are there no other questions? I'd like you guys to come up and take a closer look at these if you're interested. Certainly you can reach out to any of us anytime. If you've got more questions, the vote is on Tuesday and it is at the Conway Garage, yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Is it going to be the drive-through method?
Yeah.
Or,
yeah.
Okay. I like that.
Okay.
I really like
that.
I found the booth more comfortable listening to music. Okay. So yes, go Tuesday at the town garage.
8 a.m. to 7 a.m.
And I technically, beginning, I misspoke. Initially, we proposed this as a special exception. It is a conditional use permit. It's had so many different names, so I apologize. It's a conditional use permit. It's not a special exception.
Which is
again allowed in our code, but we've never actually implemented before, but it is allowed by us.
And all that means the difference,
basically, what it means is
in a conditional use permit, you're allowed to assign what body reviews it, and so they're able to say to the planning board. And that way, anyone who's trying to build one of these, it's just a one-stop shop. They can just go to the planning board, and if it meets all the requirements, then they can approve it. But the other beautiful piece about the CDP is you can also, I believe, even if it meets the requirements, you can say,
well, the biggest benefit to it is if there was to be a person, if there was to be something that was built and they were renting it, and we found out they were doing a short-term rental, we can pull the permit.
Whereas the 12 units per acre provision requires a two-stop review process with the zoning board of adjustment and then the planning board.
And
it just adds time to the review process, which time is money. So.
What documentation is required to vote?
I think you need proof of residency.
Yes.
Yeah.
If you're a resident of the town and have proof of it, you can register to vote at the polls the same.